Hello and welcome to worship on this Labor Day weekend, the second time we celebrate communion together as a church. And as we're turning toward fall, the weather's cooling, trees are starting to give hints of leaves changing. We're so glad to have you here joining us in worship online yet again this week. We want to begin, as we do each week, in saying thank you to the good people who make our worship possible for us this week. So we start off by saying thank you to the members of Cornerstone. First of all, our musicians, Mark, Denny, and Dini. Our vocalist this week, Sarah, and Karen. And this week we're very glad to have a father and daughter reading for us, Matt and Haley. Serving again to make all this possible are our technicians, David W. on the soundboard, and Jay and Aaron, who manage all the video that makes this possible. So thank you to all those people who help us to make worship possible. And remind you again, we're looking for people to help us serve in worship, people to read and participate in any way you're able to. You can let us know you're available to do that by visiting us online at windsorucc.com/SIW. That's for serving in worship. windsorucc.com/SIW. Also, I'd like to take a minute to remind you, some of you have heard already, and the newsletter is coming out with an article that I wrote called Can't Wait. And it's about us trying to get together and say our hellos as best we can during the pandemic. And I want to make a couple things clear that have come up since that article went out. First of all, we are looking always here to follow Madison and Dane County health guidelines, which means what we're wanting to do is meet with 10 people or less outside. We're not looking to do anything formal, no food or anything like that. You know, if we want to have something to drink or even, you know, if it's cold, maybe a cup of hot chocolate or something, we can bring that ourselves. We can meet here in the church lawn, in lawn chairs, take our masks off and shoot the breeze for a while. It's something that I'm hoping that we can do in small groups before it gets too cold for us to be outside much together. And as I have been telling the leadership of the church, I'm very eager to talk with parents of school-aged children to talk about how we as a congregation will nurture our children in faith and support our families and parents, but also to talk about the kids who need help in our community, in our schools, who don't have the kind of love and support at home that some of our children do. So I'm hoping that we can begin by getting a few of those groups together, and I can meet some of our parents with school-aged children. So if you are able to do this, you'll see here below the contact information of Nancy Miller, who's the chair of our hospitality committee. If you would get a hold of her, she can schedule it. She and I are working together so we can coordinate this. So thank you, Nancy, and thank you to all those who volunteer to be hosts and get a small group together so we can say our hellos as best we can. And now we begin, as we begin each week, with images and readings for the worship time that we have together, accompanying on piano by our music director, David Shipper, and this week also by Mark on the guitar. Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come this day seeking courage and hope for the future. Our world is in such peril. Heal the wounds and quiet the words of war. Help us to be those who seek justice in our families and communities. Banish the darkness of silence and fear. Anoint us with your light and love, that we may spread the good news of your mercy to everyone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. With no reason to pretend, and in no position to judge, let us confess our sin before God and neighbor. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Creator, in you we live and move and have our being. Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses, and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near to you, our refuge and our strength, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Friends, God hears our prayers and sends us the Spirit to change us and to empower our lives in the world. We are forgiven. God's love is unconditional, and we are raised up as God's people who will always be made new. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Friend and
The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you have to say to us today. Amen.
A reading from Exodus. Listen for the word of God. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb should be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it hurriedly. It is Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. Where I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance."
Psalm 114. Listen for the word of God. When Israel went out from Egypt, the house of Jacob, from a people of strange language, Judah became God's sanctuary, Israel his dominion. The sea looked and fled, Jordan turned back. The mountains kept like rams, the hills like lambs. Why is it, O sea, that you flee, O Jordan, that you turn your back? O mountains, that you skip like rams, O hills like lambs. Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God Jacob, who turns rock into a pool of water and flint into a spring of water.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew. Listen for the word of God. If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, Take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts this day be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our God, our rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Well, a few years back, I found myself in Branson, Missouri, watching the play of the Moses story. My wife and I were visiting dear friends of hers, the mother of one of her childhood friends. She and her husband rented a cabin and made us a lovely spaghetti dinner, and then they chauffeured us to the show. We found ourselves in a huge parking lot. It was filled with toured buses with license plates from around the United States. I remember seeing license plates from Kansas and Colorado. And as we got into the auditorium, there were thousands of people there watching the show. And some of them were wearing matching gear to show where they had come from, the journey that they had taken together. I remember seeing people from Oskaloosa, Iowa, and from Randolph, Wisconsin. And so we settled in. Thousands of people gathered to be entertained by the retelling of the Moses story that we have been reading together this past month. The Passover scene that we read this morning was the most dramatic scene of the play. With lights down low, there was special lighting revealing blood on the doorpost. Hebrew families huddled inside, and then, as night fell, and with the cries of Egyptian parents echoing in the auditorium, from the floor of the platform of the stage rose up a cross. And as the cross came up, it kept going, and it was suspended somehow by wires, and light shone on it and illuminated during the Passover scene. I was horrified. The story of the Passover for Jewish worshipers is like Easter for Christians. It's a sacred day set aside to remember, to tell the story of how God rescued them as a people, and here it was being used in service of the Christian story, being inserted into this sacred Jewish story. Passover is at the heart and foundation of the Jewish understanding of the character and nature of God, and the character and nature of God's people, who are forced into slavery by hunger and famine, and who are delivered by a God known for hearing the prayers of the oppressed. To remember this story, Jewish people celebrate Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. When they remember when they ate together and they had to be ready to run, ready to leave it all behind. As we read this morning, this is how you shall eat, your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. Huddled in fear and eating hurriedly, with no time to let the bread rise, for God is about to rescue them from slavery, but they have to be ready to move, and ready to move in a hurry. The light shining on the doorpost in Branson reflected the ways Christian church has adapted the Passover through the generations, most often by spiritualizing the blood of the Lamb, singing hymns of how the sacrifice of Christ on the cross covers our guilty sins. And when we Christians celebrate Holy Communion, we remember the night Jewish Jesus celebrated a Passover meal with the Jewish disciples. We drink the cup of forgiveness together, the cross and the meal serving to remind us that as God loves and feeds us, so we are to love and feed others. But to spiritualize the Passover story erases its profound challenges. Passover is a troubling, theologically challenging statement about the character and nature of God, a God of justice who executes righteousness against pharaonic power that uses people to build national wealth and security through cheap and exploited labor. A story about the absurdity of power that sees a species of people as less than human and responds to their cries by increasing their labor. The blindness of power that fails to see when plagues strike that the time to adjust and to change has come. We talk about a God of love in the church. We celebrate God's joy in the congregation. But we also find in Scripture a God that executes justice for the sake of those who are hard used and exploited and considered less than because they are not citizens of Egypt, because their religion is foreign, because they are dirty and speak a different language and have families so large and so full of life that they threaten Pharaoh's hold on power. Blood on the doorpost claims the character and nature of God to execute justice against the powerful on behalf of the powerless. Blood on the doorpost is God bending history justice-wise, not merely in spiritual terms, but in real physical terms, breaking iron chains that enslave human bodies. We would do well to ask how the Jewish understanding of Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread challenges our Christian understanding of the character and nature of God and inform us as Christians in our commitment to advocate for justice in our world today and demonstrate our claims in the world to be followers of God revealed in the life of Jesus Christ. Blood on the doorpost is an act of defiance. It marks the Hebrew as a people and then identifies them as members of an uprising. Should God fail them? Should Moses have been wrong in challenging Pharaoh's power? Blood on the doorpost will be a handy sign for Egyptian soldiers the next morning. Blood on the doorpost leaves no room for second guessing, for turning back. It declares a belief in God's justice and that God's power will raise up and set free all those who are oppressed. Blood on the doorpost defies Pharaoh and refuses to make bricks anymore to build his kingdom. Passover is about faithful defiance, time to stop hiding, time to admit it is no longer possible to go unnoticed, to remain passive, or to make peace with the oppressor. Time to rise up and be counted, eating hurriedly, ready to run. I have come to see that cross that rose up out of the floor during the Passover scene in Branson in a way that makes sense with Christian understandings of the character and nature of God and what it means today to follow the way of Christ in our world. The cross, after all, is an act of defiance. Jesus refusing to obey religious leaders and amassing such a large following that Herod and Caesar take notice and work together to publicly execute him, making an example of him. Jesus refuses to serve their power. to let them oppress his message of God's love and of God's kingdom, which is always in conflict with the kingdoms of the world. The cross is an example for all to see that the God who heard the cries of the Hebrews and set them free is the same God who Jesus showed us in human form, who devoted his ministry to those who were too dirty or sick or ashamed of themselves to be admitted into polite religious society. People who were too poor to exchange their money in the temple to purchase forgiveness. People who see the cross as God standing in solidarity with them, dignifying their humiliations, giving voice to their silence, making visible what religious and political authorities seek to hide. Caesar and Herod and the religious people who conspire against Jesus believe they are putting an end to him and proving to all would-be followers the cost of defying their power. But as with Pharaoh and the Passover of the Hebrews, the blood on the door, like the blood on the cross, is an act of defiance through which God sets us free. We are not only set free by the cross, we are challenged by the cross to set others free. And this marks us as a people of God and as Christians. God bless you, friends. And God bless Windsor UCC. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Lord, our God, hear our prayers and send us your Spirit that we might learn how to pray. God of peace, we remember your Son, our Lord, promised that wherever two or three of us are gathered in his name, Christ will be with us. You will be with us. The Spirit will be in us. And here we are together, not in the same building, not face to face, not sitting here with heads bowed, breathing the same air, but in our separate homes, looking at screens and listening through speakers. And yet, we are nonetheless gathered as best we can, and we are gathered as always in your Son's name. And so we pray that you would make good your promise and be with us as we navigate this hard time, that you would hold us together spiritually because we can't be together physically. Show us the way, oh, please show us the way, so that we as a people will grow strong and renew our resolve and be ready for that day when we will declare our love for you by loving our neighbors and by our courage in defying powers that silence, dismiss, ignore, belittle, or distort the cries of the oppressed for justice. O Lord our God, we continue to pray for our congregation, knowing we cannot see as you see and do not know how our members and friends are suffering. Yet hear us as we pray as best we can. On this Labor Day weekend, give us rest. Help us to pause and reflect on the ways you have lifted us up in these past few months, by how, despite all of the challenges we face together, we are ever more confident that you are with us always. Help us to find ways to celebrate the turning points in our lives, children starting school, teachers valiantly preparing to start another year, young people starting college with new challenges added to the challenge of the work of college itself. All of this, in all of this, help us to accept that what we cannot change and make sacrifices for the good of all, and give us vision to see every now and again what we will surely see when we look back later on, that you were with us and we have much to celebrate in your presence with us in our lives today. We pray for those we love and those with whom we struggle, for those times when they are the same. We pray for concerns which have not yet found words to name and for burdens born in silence. We also pray with thanksgiving for beauty and joy in our lives, which cures our souls and inspires our faith. And today, as a congregation, we remember and especially pray for the friends and family of Reverend Bob Davis. Hold us with tenderness. Grant us strength to endure and faith to thrive. Give us courage, resilience, and decisiveness. Bless us with curious, open, caring hearts, and fill us with your Spirit, no matter where we might travel. And reveal your vision to us, that we might see ourselves and others as your own beloved children in Christ, united as one human family. Into your hands, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, because God has so richly blessed us, let us receive our morning offering in gratitude for all God has done and continues to do in our lives. Thank you. Let us pray. These offerings we present to you, O Lord, may they be used for ministries of love and reconciliation through Windsor UCC. In Christ's name we pray, amen. It is an honor on behalf of the congregation of Windsor United Church of Christ to welcome all people to celebrate Holy Communion with us at this table. Let us begin. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord. Let us pray. Eternal God, who has created the heavens and earth, giving breath to every living thing, we thank you for all the gifts of creation and for the gift of life itself. We thank you for making us in your own image, for forgiving us when we act as though you have no claim on us, and for keeping us in your steadfast care. We rejoice in Jesus Christ, the only one eternally begotten by you, who was born of your servant Mary, and who shared the joys and sorrows of life as we know it. We remember Christ's death, we celebrate Christ's resurrection, and in the beloved community of your church, we await Christ's return at the end of history. We take courage from the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit that gathers us together as your church, with all the prophets, martyrs, and saints, and all the company in heaven. Together we glorify your name. Amen. Friends, in the night, betrayal, and desertion, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave it to all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this to remember me." Let us pray. Consecrate by your Holy Spirit, we pray, these gifts of bread and wine, and bless us that as we receive them at this table, we may offer you our faith and praise, and we may be united with Christ and with one another, and we may continually to grow in faith. And now let us pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory forever. Amen." Amen. Friends, through the broken bread, we participate in the body of Christ. Through the cup of blessing, and the cup of forgiveness, we participate in the new life Christ gives. Come, for all things are ready. David is going to play some music for us while we celebrate communion in our homes. And though we are gathered online, what Jesus says remains true even today. Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. Amen. Thank you. now let us pray together our unison prayer of thanksgiving. Let us pray. We affirm the goodness of life and the openness of the future because our God is a God of life and love. As God comes to us in this act of communion with one another, let us go out to others in Jesus' name. May our every prayer be an action that brings healing, reconciliation, and hope to a broken and hurting world. Amen. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.